members of our the electronic structure community, as we know it today, not just for the tools, because he's one of the founders of the quantum espresso distribution code. That is something that pretty much many of us use on every day's research, but also in terms of theoretical frameworks. He has been developing a number of them, starting from linear response, for instance, theory on phonons within density functional theory, and then moving closer to excitations, also methods like the Turbo-Lanthos approach in time-dependent density functional theory, then applied to GW and the beta salpeter, where basically you avoid any spectral representation of the Hamiltonian and some overstates, and so on, and lately also some reformulation of thermal transport in ionic systems and so on. So overall, it's a real pleasure to have Stefano here, and is just great also for this course. So please, Stefano, stage is yours.
Grazie, thank you very much, Andrea. Very flattering introduction. I'm probably blushing a little bit. So one usually asks the older.
No, that's fine. I'll use it.
Okay.
I actually don't need it because I usually speak too loud without any microphone and people keep complaining. Okay, I will. Okay. So not sure I was very happy to accept the invitation. Of course, I'm honored. But one usually asks the older guy in the audience to open the school. And that's why I was asked. Actually, asking the oldest person in the audience has some risks, because old man sometime need physiotherapy, and that's why I missed the first lecture. Now I'm in good shape, and I have been properly manipulated, and I'm here for the whole 40 minutes with you to talk about, not material science, not even too broad, not even computer simulations in material science, too broad as well. Just a very, very small angle of some technical questions and some general ideas and introduction. And I will finish, hopefully, the last 10 minutes or so of my talk by introducing techniques within density functional theory that allow you to compute spectral properties in materials that are due to lattice fluctuations, to lattice vibrations, which are not quite what you will be learning this week, but in a sense it's preliminary. So infrared and Raman spectroscopy in materials are mostly describable in the adiabatic approximation, where you can pretend that the electrons stay in their ground state while the nuclei vibrate. And that's why you can address those excitations in the adiabatic approximation, where you pretend that the electrons stay in their ground state, so that you can deal with all of those phenomena within strictly ground state density functional theory. I will introduce a few general concepts of perturbation theory that may or may not turn out to be useful for you in understanding what will be the main core of this course, that is excitations due not to nuclear and lattice vibrations, but to charge fluctuations that break the adiabatic approximation, and then you will see what it is about in the rest of the week. So, every experience of ours, of man, is collocated in space and time, right? And when you ask yourself how to study a phenomenon, how to simulate a process, you have to ask yourself, first of all, on which time and length scales those phenomena occur. For instance, tools that are appropriate to describe phenomena on the cosmological time and length scales most likely won't be appropriate to study molecular vibrations, and vice versa. So I think it's a good idea to frame our mind onto the length and time scales that characterize the processes occurring in materials. And by and large, you can think of phenomena that occur at the macroscopic scale, that is the realm of classical mechanics, where you can disregard all quantization phenomena, and you can treat materials as continuous media. And on the opposite side, so those are phenomena that are directly accessible to our senses, right? Things that you can touch and you can watch and you can listen to. This is, by and large, the realm of 18th century, 19th century science and of much of modern engineering. Not all of that, but much of modern engineering. On the opposite, the length scale there are millimeters, meters, kilometers, something that you can see and count by yourself, and the time scale will be fractions of seconds up to several seconds, hours, or whatever. On the opposite end of this length and time scale, you have phenomena occurring at the molecular scale, which occur on times that are a fraction or a small multiple of a picosecond. A picosecond is a millionth of a second. That is the typical vibrational time scale of molecules and solids, and that occur on a length scale that is a fraction or a small multiple of a nanometer, of a billionth of a meter. Those are phenomena that that are affected dramatically by quantum effects, and in between there is some kind of terra incognita. So we know by now rather well how to deal with phenomena, with quantum phenomena at the nanoscale. We know since many decades or a few centuries how to deal with macroscopic phenomena better and better. And in between, the regime where the quantum world reaches and matches the classical one is something that we still do not know exactly how to deal with. It's the realm of the coherence, where the coherence that is typical of quantum phenomena is lost by the interaction with the classical world. It's the mysterious world of quantum measurement and all the like. Of course, different length and time scales, not surprisingly, require different theoretical tools to address, and we go from the macroscopic scale, that is the scale of classical electromagnetism, of classical thermodynamics and finite elements, down to methods that are characterized by a high degree of stochasticity, so that you need to account for phenomena that occurs at a time scale that is much longer than that of the elementary molecular events that occur at the nanoscale, but much shorter than the macroscopic scales. So this is the realm of kinetic methods, kinetic Monte Carlo methods. Going down in time and length scales, you have a classical molecular dynamics, where you disregard the quantum nature of the interaction between atoms and molecules, and you account for the motion of the nuclei by simply solving Newton's equations of motion. And going down, we arrive at the realm of electronic structure methods that are the topic of today's and this week's course. Of course, size, length, and time matter. They go with different methods, but different methods have different numerical resolutions and different predictive power according to the approximations that have to be implemented in them and according to the numerical complexity that you have to face in order to solve the equations of those methods. So going in order of increasing, usually when you increase the accuracy, so you increase the resolution, you are forced to go what I meant is when you have very large systems, you have to adopt methods that are necessarily not as accurate as you would use for small systems. So in a sense, high accuracy go with small systems and large systems go with low accuracy. And going in order of increasing accuracy and decreasing system size, you go from classical empirical methods, such as pair potentials, force fields, and shell methods, where you totally disregard the quantum nature of the chemical bonds. Then you can introduce some degree of quantum behavior using semi-empirical methods, which are, however, based on quantum models such as tight binding or embedded atom methods. And then we go in order of increasing accuracy to quantum self-consistent methods such as Hartree-Fock that you just learned about from Andrea, or density functional theory that I will address in the next half an hour or so. Hartree-Fock is an approximate method. density functional theory in principle is not. In principle, it is a rigorous theory. However, its implementation requires severe approximation, which necessarily limit the accuracy and scope of applicability of density functional theory. So in order to increase the accuracy, you have to resort to methods where the wave function nature of quantum states is taken explicitly into account, either directly using wave functions, such as in quantum chemistry method, or using this representation in terms of Green's functions that will be the main topic of this week. So self-consistent methods are implemented in Quantum Espresso, and these Green's functions based quantum methods are implemented in Yambo, which we will learn how to use this week. So we are all here to learn how to do ab initio calculations. So one hears time and again, over and over again, this and that computation has been performed from first principles or ab initio. What does this expression technically mean? What we mean, actually, chemists and physicists give a slightly different meaning to this expression. What we physicists and more chemists now mean by ab initio methods are methods that allow to simulate the properties of materials using the basic laws of nature, that is the Schrödinger equation and Maxwell equations, so classical electrodynamics, and the chemical composition as the sole input ingredients. Which means that in principle you do not use any information from experiment, or as little information as possible from experiment. Why this is a good idea? Not because of narcissism. Many of us, so scientists, have a narcissistic attitude, many of us. So we want to show how clever we are, how good we are to solve difficult problems, and we do things ab initio. We close our eyes. We don't ask any help to anybody in the laboratory, and still we are able to predict. So this is to some extent, but this is not the real motivation. The real motivation is that predictivity goes with lack of bias. So when you have semi-empirical methods, the method and the model that you build is biased by the ingredients that you put into the model. And you don't know a priori how the model that you build on some specific, using the knowledge on some specific system, in some specific physico-chemical conditions, how that model would apply for systems with a different chemical composition, or even with the same chemical composition at very different chemical-physical conditions, for instance, in a different bonding environment or at very different pressure of temperature. So ab initio methods may be wrong. They are not necessarily good. You have to learn how to tell if they are good and if they are not. But even if they are not, they are wrong in an unbiased way. So once you get acquainted with the accuracy, how to estimate the accuracy of those methods, you can be confident, and not totally sure, but increasingly confident that a calculation that you do for a system that nobody has ever studied you learn how to appraise more or less the accuracy that you can expect from the experience on systems that are different from the one that you are considering. When? Of course, those methods are expensive, DFT is expensive, and many body perturbation theory is much more expensive than DFT. So we have this narcissistic attitude, but narcissism has to be justified, has to be hidden, because it is not very, very good to show that you are narcissistic. But when you are, and you have to justify it, and the justification is that you don't want to tackle a problem. You don't want to do whatever just because your supervisor wants you to do that. You have to be sure that the problem that you are given is worth your time, and the problem is worth your time if any other simpler and cheaper approximations wouldn't apply, and if the approximations that you necessarily have to do have a good chance to give a result you can trust. I often hear at conferences people of your age, and I invite them, I would like to be your age, but when asked, you're applying a method that is well known not to be good for the system that you are dealing with. And one often hears the answer, well, there is no better method. This is not a good answer. I mean, if the method that you have is not good to solve your problem, either you improve the method or you change the problem. It is a shame to waste your time and the time of your supervisor and the time and the money it takes to pay computers to apply a method that does not solve any problem because you don't trust the numbers that you get out of your calculations. And then we all, so our tool is of course computers. We are computational physicists or chemists, and computers are not enough. Computers need the clever algorithms, and clever algorithms, in order to be devised, require you to understand the physics, you have the math of the problem, and you have to get as much as possible familiar with the math and to know what the codes you are using really do. Codes have to be efficient, and the results that you get have not to clash with common sense and scientific rigor. You have always to know what the error is, how can I estimate the error bar, how likely it is that the number that I get allows me to really answer the question, the clever question, the important question that I asked in the first place. So ab initio simulations, different communities mean different things. In our community, the holy grail, the thing everybody would like to be able to solve is the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, where that regulates the time evolution of a wave function that depends on a zillion of nuclear coordinates that I indicate here with capital letters, and a zillion, actually several zillions of lowercase coordinates that are electronic coordinates. You have the kinetic energy of the nuclei, the kinetic energy of the electrons, and the potential energy that accounts for the interaction of the nuclei with the electrons among themselves, that damned correlation effects that gives rise to correlation effects, and nuclei among themselves. The very first important approximation that almost invariably is done very important phenomena are due to the breakdown of this approximation, but we will not address that breakdown here, not I think, nor I think elsewhere in this course. Maybe yes, some electron phonon interactions, I don't know if you will cover it. But basically, because the nuclei are much heavier than electrons, you can, in a first approximation, neglect the kinetic energy of the nuclei with respect to the kinetic energy of the electrons. And if you do so, you basically break the time-dependent Schrödinger equation into a set of two coupled equations. The first one is a time-independent Schrödinger equation for the electrons that depend parametrically on the nuclei. Parametrically means that this Hamiltonian there, the electronic Hamiltonian, does not contain any differential term in the nuclear coordinates. So for every set of nuclear coordinates, you have a well-defined electronic Hamiltonian, electronic wave function that depends parametrically on the nuclear positions. Because the Hamiltonian depends parametrically on the nuclear position, the eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian depend on the nuclear position, depend on this R index. And it is exactly this dependence that gives rise to the interatomic forces, to the extent that, because the nuclei are heavy, you can, to a good approximation, many times you can deal with them classically and solve classical Newton's equations of motion for the nuclei. Let's say that the acceleration of each nucleus is proportional to the force acting on the nucleus. And the force is nothing but the derivative of the energy that depends parametrically on nuclear coordinates with respect to the nuclear coordinates. So, in principle, you have to solve this time-independent Schrödinger equation for the electrons alone, which is much simpler than the previous equation because you have disposed of the nuclear degrees of freedom, but still is very complex. And the reason of this complexity is the existence of this electron-electron interaction that is such that the eigenfunctions of this Schrödinger equation cannot be written as a product or even anti-symmetrized product, for that matter, of one particle equations. So you cannot solve this equation by solving each electron at a time, which is what you do in Hartree-Fock. In Hartree-Fock, you can attach a molecular orbital in one electron state to each electron, and it is much easier to solve. In density function theory, technically you do the same thing. Conceptually it's very different from Hartree-Fock, but technically what you do is to replace the effect of this electron-electron interaction. You replace it with an effective one electron potential, which, however, as in Hartree-Fock, depends on the solution itself. How? It depends on the solution through the orbitals, because the system now is non-interacting. You have no longer an electron-electron interaction, but only an external potential. Then you can solve the Schrödinger equation one electron at a time, so that you can attach molecular orbitals to each individual electron, and the sum of the square moduli of those electron of those molecular orbitals is the so-called electron charge density distribution, upon which the external potential depends, so that you have to solve this equation self-consistently, because the wave functions depend on the potential, but the potential depends on the density, but the density depends on the wave functions, so that you have to solve them self-consistently. I will skip the technical part of
let me so basically in density functional theory what you have that is that this potential that depends on the density is the external potential that is given by the system. It is the potential exerted by the nuclei on the electrons by the nuclei or by some external field, plus the Hartree potential, that is the electrostatic potential generated by the ground state charge density distribution rho over r, plus the so-called exchange correlation potential that depends on the density and on the position in space. When Andrea before was speaking about Feynman and the correlations, he forgot probably, I don't know if on purpose for what reason, to give Feynman's definition of correlation energy. Andrea, you know what the Feynman's definition? It's at page 33 or whatever of his textbook on statistical mechanics. You go to the electron gas, and then he speaks of correlation energy in that occasion. And there is a note where he calls the correlation energy not EC, it calls it ES. Why S? It is the stupidity energy. It is the name that we give to what we cannot compute. Feynman digs it, not me. Okay, so DFD gives you a recipe to compute the stupidity energy, the stupidity potential, once you know the density, and this gives you a practical way of iterating those one-particle Schrödinger equation, as I tried to explain a while ago. So there are many different recipes for computing the stupidity energy as a functional of the density. The density functional theory owes its name to the fact that it is based on a functional. What is a functional? It is a function whose argument is itself a function. Right? It is a recipe to compute a number out of a function. Rho of r is a function of space, point by point, a function of three arguments, x, y, z, and the exchange correlation energy is a functional of the density in the sense that given a functional form of the density, there are recipes to compute the stupidity energy. There are very many different recipes that are available. The only recipe that was available till for the first 20 years of existence of density functional theory was the local density approximation that that chemists considered with despise. So they were against the density functional theory until when better approximations to the local density approximation were devised, to the extent that the inventor of density functional theory, Walter Kohn, who was no chemist himself, got a Nobel Prize of Chemistry for chemistry in 98 or 99, at the end of the past century. And that was possible because at some point, the development of very sophisticated functionals, much more accurate than the local density approximation, convinced the chemistry community that DFT is indeed a viable method to compute molecular properties. I will not go into any of those approximations. Basically, DFT amounts five more. DFT amounts to solving the one-body Schrödinger equation. And in order to do that, what you have to do is to expand your molecular orbitals into a basis set. Then the coefficients of this expansion become the functional unknowns of your system. By computing the extremum of the DFT energy with respect to those molecular orbitals, imposing the orthonormality condition, imposing the fact that those molecular orbitals have to be orthonormal with respect to each other, you end up with a generalized optimization problem that you can solve directly, and I have erased what you would do to solve it directly with general optimization algorithms. What most people would do is to solve instead a self-consistent set of Schrödinger equations that have become, because of the expansion in this basis set, has been cast into an algebraic eigenvalue problem where the Hamiltonian to be diagonalized is a matrix, is a matrix of finite dimension that depends non-linearly upon its solutions. So the solutions is this array of complex numbers, and the density depends on that array of complex numbers, and because the Hamiltonian, because the potential depends on the density, the Hamiltonian depends on the density and hence on the eigenfunctions, so that this Hamiltonian to be diagonalized depends on its own solutions. We call this kind of Schrödinger equation a self-consistent Schrödinger equation. Mathematicians would call it the same thing. For a mathematician, is a non-linear Schrödinger equation. It is non-linear because this Hamiltonian depends on C, so the left-hand side of this equation is non-linear. If you multiply C by a number, the left-hand side is not multiplied by that number, but becomes something very different. So when you look into the mathematics literature, when they say nonlinear Schrödinger equation, what they mean is what we would mean by self-consistent equation. So you want your basis set to be complete because the Hilbert space of one particle orbitals has an infinite dimension, and you want a finite reduction of that infinite dimensional space to be as accurate as possible. You want the matrix elements of the Hamiltonian to be easy to compute, and or, which is equivalent, the product of the Hamiltonian times an orbital to be easily calculated on the fly. Hartree and exchange correlation potentials have to be easy to represent and calculate, and if possible, if you manage to have an orthonormal basis set, that would simplify your life. Plane waves are such a basis set with which you can easily deal with periodic systems. Actually, plane waves were devised in the first place to deal with periodic crystals, but you can deal with non-periodic systems such as even a molecule by mimicking it with a periodic array of non-periodic systems. So if you have a molecule here, this is a sketch of a water molecule in color, and you can pretend that the properties of the molecule are the same as the properties of a molecular crystal, which you pretend, but if the lattice spacing of the molecular crystal is large enough, actually this is the case indeed. If the distance between neighboring molecules is much larger than the dimension of the molecules, then periodicity does not harm your results. Periodicity helps the computation. So this so-called supercell method, that is the periodical repetition of non-periodic units, is a very important tool in our business. So plane waves have many desirable properties. I will not comment upon this, nor this. They have the good property that completeness is very easy to check, because it only depends on a parameter, just one parameter, that is the maximum kinetic energy that is representable with that with those plane waves. You have just one parameter upon which the whole numerical accuracy of your problem depends. Then matrix elements are easy to compute, densities are easy to compute, they are orthonormal, and so they have lots of very good properties. The real great drawback is that they have uniform spatial resolution. So the resolution of a plane wave is the space resolution is determined by the wavelength of the plane wave, and the resolution is the same all over the space. This is not good, because atoms have of which molecules and materials are made, have the nasty property of being held together the electrons that form the chemical bond are prevented from collapsing onto the nucleus by the core electrons that are chemically inert, but that have a space resolution that is much, much, much finer than the space resolution of valence electrons. In fact, a 1s core state has a space dimension that scales as the inverse of the atomic number of that number of the Bohr radius of the 1s state of uranium, say, is 1/100th the Bohr radius of in hydrogen, and the maximum kinetic energy that a 1s core state uranium has is the square of Z. So it is 10 to the fourth the kinetic energy of an electron of a hydrogen atom. So you would need a huge number of plane waves just for the sake of describing electrons that you don't care about, because they don't form any chemical bonds. So they are just to prevent the valence electron of heavy elements to collapse into the nucleus. So the solution of this is this pseudo-potential method on which both Quantum Espresso and Yambo are based. Basically, in a nutshell, the concept of pseudo-potential is a potential that does not have any core states, but that only has valence states. But the valence states of the pseudo-atom are as close as possible to the real valence states. In particular, they have to coincide with the real valence states there, where valence electrons form the chemical bond, because I want the chemical bond of pseudo-atoms to be the same as the chemical bond of real atoms. But because pseudo-atoms do not have core states, the valence states that have nodes in reality, because valence states have to be orthogonal to core states. The pseudo-valent states have to be nodeless because they have nothing to be orthogonal to, right? So the recipe is very simple. The recipe to construct a pseudo-potential is conceptually very simple. You start from an atomic orbital. Here is the 3s atomic orbital of silicon. And then you invent any wave function, any orbital, that coincides with the real wave function in the valence region. You see here the dotted line and the continuous line are indistinguishable in the valence region. And in the core region, you just make it nodeless. Then you impose that the norm of the pseudo wave function is one. It has to be the same as the norm of the real wave function, and you simply invert the Schrödinger equation. What you do? So this equation there, that orbital there, satisfies the radial Schrödinger equation that says that the second derivative of the orbital, that is the kinetic energy, plus the potential times the orbital is equal to the eigenvalue times the orbital. So that you have that minus chi double prime over chi is equal to epsilon minus v, so that you have that v is equal to chi double prime over chi minus epsilon. Very simple. If you have a wave function, and you have fabricated the wave function with the desired properties, to be as close as possible to the real wave function, to have the good norm, and to be nodeless. Once you have the wave function, you have the potential. You just invert the Schrödinger equation, and the ratio between the second derivative of the wave function and the wave function is equal to the potential modulo a constant. That's the way pseudo-potentials are constructed. And you do the same for different orbitals. So for the 3s, you do that for 3p, for 3d, and you have different pseudo potentials for different angular momenta. So you have all the ingredients. You have a functional that some highbrow theorist has produced for you. You have pseudo potentials that some nerdy scientist has fabricated for you. And you have codes that some other nerdy people have worked on for the decades. You have the chemical composition of your system. You just feed your computer code with the geometry, with the chemical composition, the positions of the atoms, the functional of your choice, and you have to be good at choosing the right functional for the right accuracy and the right class of materials. So this is a very, very complex and non-trivial endeavor. And you solve the Schrödinger equation. The Schrödinger equation gives you eigenvalues and orbitals, with which you can compute ground state properties right away. You don't need any many-body perturbation theory to do that. And you can compute phonons and the response. What happens here? And response functions that I was planning to talk about, but I won't have the time to do so. I will stop in 1-2 minutes. The takeaway message is that with this framework, you can compute all the properties that rigorously, strictly, all the properties that can be expressed in terms of local operators. Local operators are operators that are diagonal in the coordinate representations, so that the expectation value of a local operator can be local and one body operator can be expressed as integrals of the density that is given by DFT and the representation of the operator in this way. So you have the expectation value of an operator would be the integral of rho of R times O of R dr. So all the local operators, all the expectation values of local operators can be rigorously computed within DFT. It is common practice, not rigorously founded, but common practice that everybody would follow, also to compute expectation values of non-local operators, such as, or semi-local operators, such as momentum distributions, for instance. The momentum distribution of currents, they're not strictly expectation values. You cannot express them in terms of anything like that. You would need the derivatives. And derivatives, differential operators, cannot be exactly represented in density functional theory, but everybody would do. Close their eyes and hope for the best. You do this, and you can compute all static response functions, such as the electric constants and piezoelectric constants, elastic constants. All of those can be computed, including those response functions that are responsible for lattice vibrations. It may seem unexpected that in order to compute vibrational frequencies you need the response functions. Actually, it is not quite so, because basically what you need in order to compute vibrational frequencies is the second derivative of the energy, the ground state energy of a system that is given, that is provided by DFT. So this can be computed by DFT with respect to the positions of the nuclei. But this is nothing but the derivative minus the derivative of the force acting. So the second derivative is the first derivative of the first derivative, right? So d over dr is the force acting on atom r. And d over dr prime, what is it? Is the derivative of the force acting on atom r when you move atom r prime off equilibrium. And what is this? This is a response function. It is how much it changes the force on one atom when you perturb a little bit the position of another. So if you have a general framework to compute the static response functions, and density functional perturbation theory provides you with such a framework, you can compute interatomic force constants, and from interatomic force constants, you can compute phonon dispersions and electron phonon couplings and superconductivities and thermal properties and lots of properties I won't have the time to talk about today. So I prepared this last picture in assuming that I would have had the time to explain in some detail how to compute those vibrational frequencies that are the manifestation of lattice fluctuations. I didn't really do that, but those of you who are interested to know more would be most welcome to come to me for a private or a group chat. And this week you will learn how to go beyond and to compute the excitation energies that are due not to lattice vibrations that can be dealt with in the adiabatic approximation, but with electron charge fluctuations that break the adiabatic approximation. So all of what I would have talked about concerning lattice vibration and stuff is implemented in the quantum espresso suite of computer codes that you would likely use as a prerequisite for your many-body perturbation theory calculations for this week as well. And all of this is supported by the Quantum Espresso Foundation, a not-for-profit company that fosters the development of Quantum Espresso, and the Max European Center of Excellence for Supercomputing Applications. MAX is an acronym for materials at the exascale. And that's it. Thank you very much. Those of you